Chapter 9, 12 years later in the White Tower. Lancaster sits on his bed reading a tome. A servant walks in and says, "You have a visitor, sir. Send him in then," says Lancaster. Norman walks in with an unusual smile on his face. "An apostate, I thought I would never see the day," Norman exclaims jokingly. "I've gotten you off the noose, Lancaster. You are free from White Tower now," says Norman. Lancaster continues reading and turns a page, then closes the tome hard. "That is fantastic, Norman. Thank you, my old friend. I will leave when fate wills it, but for now I shall stay here and catch up on my reading and studies." Norman holds up a glass box. Lancaster is very surprised at what he sees. "I bought it on the black market," says Norman. "It is the heart of eternity, back to its rightful place in White Tower. We shall put it back where it belongs. This is a great day indeed." Lancaster celebrates. Ascetia, the world's hope for justice and reason, is in a state of rebuilding still, even after so many years. The war with Fendrackle decimated it, but the tides go on, ever-changing, but steady. The nations maintain their peace once more, and at last the heart of eternity is restored, and Lancaster's immortality with it. Norman and Lancaster spend a good amount of the day talking about what befell Ascetia City. Norman pets Lancaster's imp, then leans up against the room wall with his arm crossed. Later that day, they go down to view the rebuild efforts and are just out of for a stroll. They look to both sides to view men and even their sons rebuilding alongside them, large wooden and iron machines being used to pull up the wood and stone. "What devastation," says Norman with a high brow. Lancaster responds, "Of course," just as the two find a shaded spot to gander at things. Dan and McBride appears in secret to watch the two from behind a corner, his bazaar ever-present, moving as a still shadow. Before the two can spot him, he disappears into it, and it along with him. 12 years later, in the town of High Post, Hecron, Darkin's good-hearted brother, is writing a letter on golden paper in his windmill tower. It is written for both Norman and Lancaster. He paces and sits to write, often rubbing his forehead. Orcs were almost wiped out by King Ascetia. Now they are no more a marauding force, but travel with gypsies and elves, and usually can be found among bandits at their camps, either as bandits themselves or as mercenaries. Orcs usually have brownish to green and brownish skin and have four sets of fanged teeth. They are somewhat short to average and broad, fancy large weapons, whereas elves favor bows and daggers. The two rarely interbreed but can. The result is known throughout the wilds as a felgen, and their elven traits usually overpower their orcish ones quite a bit. They are usually taller and skinnier than orcs are. What orcs lack in number, they always make up for by carrying a highly trained red dragon whelp into battle, but it is never fully grown. The full-grown ones are too powerful. Red dragons live deep in the mountains. I want you to hunt down the leader of the bandits here near High Post, both of you. Samson will meet you at the castle, along with King Hevar. The bandit captain is a felgen named Hecabro. He and his men have been spotted just outside the town. They have never posed much of a threat until now. Samson will fill you in on the details. Wanted alive back at the castle, but otherwise it's also permittable. Norman will get a similar note, but make haste to High Post. Best wishes, Hecron, resident rogue wizard of High Post. Lancaster received the letter just a week later by an official messenger on horseback. He is lounging around his tower as he reads over the letter. In Hevar's golden paper, in his official seal of approval. Even though he knows most of what Hecron is saying, he is bound for Norman now, and Samson. With a wave of his hand, he turns off all his trinkets and braziers and makes his way outside. It is somewhat cloudy outside, so he brings his traveling garb. He does not fully trust Hecron because he is Darkin's younger brother, but from what he has heard, he cannot be all that bad, but still, he is mindful. He knows he should make haste. The letter sounds urgent, but he instead takes some time to sit under a tree and read a tome, twirling the leaves as he picks them up. He lights one on fire with his fingers and it turns to ashes almost instantly, the ashes spiraling in the wind. At this point in time, Lancaster is starting to show some age, despite having the Heart of Eternity return to White Tower. The tower still stands after the massive attack that took place there, but they have yet to let Lancaster back into the fold there. His long, straight, whitish hair is tucked behind one ear and loose on the other. He looks lean, yet his average-sized frame doesn't get around like it used to. Otherwise, he looks quite young still. He sympathizes with the orcs of the north. He does not want to do this mission and is thinking of going to Hyphos personally to back out of it. Lancaster enjoys the simple life now, but knows that this could redeem himself in the eyes of the people again. He, however, is leaning more towards backing out and just focusing on getting back into White Tower. The Archmage there said it would be only a matter of time, and that since he was Archmage before him, he had done so many heroic deeds, a test would not be needed. He leans back even further against the tree and smiles to himself. He puts the envelope back in his traveling garb and just sits there, staring up at the few leaves falling down from somewhat brown and crinkled leaves. At a remote bandit camp outside of High Post, Hecabro is sitting on a large stone, sharpening his cutting axe with a sharpening tool. There is a red dragon chained up against a very large tree close to the camp, and a bandit throws him a whole dead lamb, and it swallows it up in one big gulp. Hecabro raises his hand and yells confidently, "The time of the marauding orc is going to return. What end of the blade would you like to be on?" The bandits cheer, massing nearly over 100. Some orcs, some men. "That scout is dead, but he found out too much. They will be expecting our attack, so I have a surprise for them," said Hecabro. A bandit then asks, "What, boss?" Hecabro laughs and says, "Why, the baby red dragon, of course. If we make our move soon enough, we can lure its parents into town and stage an attack that way." "Brilliant, boss," says one of them as they sip beers, sitting cross-legged in front of a bonfire with chicken bones in it. "We have been using a scent blocker bought by a caravan to mask the odor from them so far, but once we hide it in a hypost somehow, at least one of its parents will come, and not being able to find their baby, we'll go berserk." Hecabro yells in a celebratory fashion. While the bandits are all celebrating in their camp, the scout's brown steed walks up and two road guards ride into High Post, and one says, "The scout's horse, quickly search it." The other then inquires, "Where is the scout's we sent?" One notices a satchel on the horse and goes through it, and to his surprise finds a note written hastily inside that reads, "Extreme danger." One of the guards looks and says, "This must have been written as a last-ditch effort." They both run back through town towards Castle High Post to tell King Hevar. They make their way to his throne and humbly request an audience, but he is busy talking to a noblewoman and her husband. The guards wait impatiently. "Please, sir, if I may," says one of them. Hevar looks at them and tells the noblewoman and her husband to wait in the guest room. King Hevar then looks them over and says, "Speak at will, men." The guard looks at each other and hands him the note. "What is the meaning of this?" he asks. The guard on the right answers, "It was found on the horse the scout was using. It must have made its way back to the town. We think it was a last-ditch effort to warn you of a coming danger posed by the bandits." Hevar glares to the side. "But aren't you guards on their payroll?" The guards look nervously and do not answer. Hevar gets more comfortable in his throne and says, "Right then." He then points to the doors far off and says, "I'm expecting Norman Gall, Creon Sampson, and the powerful wizard Lancaster to be summoned within a few days for a meeting. It is then that we will deal with this before the attack even happens, hopefully using diplomacy." The day goes on, but news travels fast in a place like High Post. People talk and gossip. People are on edge and even ever watchful of the roads leading out of town. Travelers are urged to make shorter trips and avoid the bandits at all costs. Hevar's strong allegiance with King Hydas and Silverstone has brought hope to the Tenth City. With large regiments of official armsmen and mercenaries of Hydas being drilled and trained along with Hevar's men and women, Creon is having a duel with one of the mercenaries outside the castle barracks with the other onlookers. A shield tightly strapped to each elbow, and the mercenary with only one and a sword, Samson's axe, bombard his shield, denting it bad, and the mercenary falls to the ground. "Evade, then!" Samson yells. As things die down, so does the talk, and the night is that like any other. The moist high post air, the gentle breeze, the squeak of Hecron's windmill tower can be heard in the distance. All of a sudden, a massive red dragon explodes out of one of the mountains, roaring and shaking the ground with upheaval. The town in a panic. She catches the scent of her young not far away, and heads that way, scorching the trees. She bears down on the bandits sleeping in the cage, the bandits taking off in all directions in fear. She takes the baby up and heads back into the mountain. The shaking lowers, but the lava oozes forth from the top of the rocks and into the many rivers. Luckily, Samson lowers his brow and squints his eyes. When he catches second wind, he will head back to his tribe. Escadia lives in infamy.